So, although we've talked to a lot of foreign publishers across the ocean here at Essen, it's really good to find familiar faces here, American yes. faces here at the International Spieltag.
I'm foreign here.
Yes, you know? Yes, and so are we.
Yeah, someone reminded me of that today.
We're the interlopers, so we're here with Todd Rowland of AEG, and you teased us a lot at Gen Con about some things that were coming up.
Am I a tease?
You are. You Ooh. totally are.
It's the first time.
So we're going to find out about the game that was super secret, so super secret,
yes.
we had to actually come here and follow you to Essen
yes.
to find out about it. Let's start
It
there.
Was so super secret, we almost didn't have it even. That was an exciting day yesterday that it was caught in customs, but it finally arrived today at lunchtime. It is Guildhall. Guildhall is our new card game from Ho Kwong. He's from South Korea. We met him at the Tokyo Game Fair, a game market in Tokyo.
Okay.
And the game is where you are building sets of cards in different professions. There are six different professions, five different colors of each, and multiple copies of every color. You draw them into your hand, and you play them into your guild. And as you build the set in your guild, the abilities of that profession get more powerful. So if you play one dancer, you have the ability to draw a card from the deck every turn. If you have three dancers, you can draw two with each action.
Mm-hmm.
But the problem becomes, when you to win the game, to get your victory points, you have to complete a set of five and then cash it in. So you lose the ability for a while until you can rebuild it. And you can't, for instance, be working on two sets of farmers at once because you can only have one copy of each color of that one out. So once you've cashed in your farmers, they're gone for a while.
You have to start all the way over if you want to start farmers again.
Right, exactly. So there's some risk in there of, wow, you know, this is having these assassins is great every turn, but I'm going to have to get rid of them if I want to win, and then I'm not going to be able to stop the other people who might play catch-up as well. Plus, once you reach the fifth one anyway, the only way you can activate an ability is by playing one. So once you play the fifth one, you get the most effect, but then you're cashing out for it. So so that's Guildhall. Like I say, it's a relatively simple game. Six professions to choose from right now. The designer had created like 25, I think.
Wow,
so we've got a potential to grow in it. But Guildhall did just arrive, and we're very excited.
I like how we, in our previous conversations about it, sort of incorporating some classic card game terms, talking about those five cards as a book of cards,
right? Exactly.
As you would. I like designers who obviously kind of have a mindset that wants to think old and bring some of those things into the fore in modern games too. I think that's really cool.
Yeah, and you can kind of tell. You know, you can sense the. It feels natural when it plays because of the older games that you played when you were little or that your grandparents played with you and stuff, you know, but it has gamer sensibility in it because you have abilities on the cards and strategy in choosing when to access them and, you know, when do I really need to go for that five assassin move right before I lose them all and planning ahead, things like that. So there's a lot to the game with a relatively, I'd say, a comfortable underpinning of how to play. Is one way to look at it. So.
Now, with Guildhall, many of your games are set in a particular fictional universe, and the world of the game sort of becomes
right.
as much, the games live within that world, and the world's actually larger than any one game.
Exactly.
With Guildhall, it's a standalone thing at this point, right?
Yes, Guildhall is its own setting. We went for more of a Dark Ages. We were actually kind of looking at it as a Dark Ages employment office, right? Because we have all these professions, and so they're all trying to get work in the guild, and so that's kind of what we were going for. We didn't want to set it, say, in Tempest or L5R or something like that. We just wanted it to be its own setting that it could grow, and we wouldn't have to worry about meshing in with new ideas that we have.
Makes sense. Now, speaking of games with worlds,
yes.
we've kind of talked about it a lot, but we haven't actually gotten to see it in its actual real form here. We have the Tempest.
Tempest
games.
Is here, the whole series, this being Dominare. Dominare is probably the largest of all of them. It's an area control game, and in it you have the whole cast of Tempest, all over 100 characters, all with their own card, their own abilities, their own things to do, and as you use a small number of them in your conspiracy each game, you have tons of replay because you're going to get all different combinations of them. And like I say, it's an area control game. You're using your agent's abilities. You're trying to keep your conspiracy as hidden as possible. The more powerful a person you put in, the more notorious they are, that it's going to raise your exposure. If you're the most exposed conspiracy, you kind of get kicked around by events a little more. However, if you're the least exposed, that probably means you're playing people like the beggar and the Pickpocket, who have almost no notoriety, but also almost no major power. Mm. They might have a slick little effect every so often, but it's not like it's the bishop who can just take over the entire church district for you. So there's a lot of balance going on there. And we also have the three other releases for Tempest so far right now in Courtier. Some people are calling it Courtier. I call it Courtier. Whatever people want to call it is fine with me. That one, you're trying to complete petitions for in the royal court, winning over the nobles and trying to get them to vote on your side. It's not really a voting game per se, but by having influence on them, you can win them to your petition.
And again, some of the personalities and things from, say, Dominare end up filtering into
exactly,
Courtier,
exactly. Right? And in Courtier, it's a lot of the higher ranking people in the city, because they're in the Queen's Court and only the top ones get to go. At the end of the game concludes when the card "The Queen is Arrested" comes up, which is part of the story. She gets arrested because of her flights of fancy and just spending too much of the money and the rise of the Senate. Yes, welcome to Essen, everybody. We get to hear this kind lady.
We're in Germany, if you didn't figure that out. You know now.
You now have placement for us. She's a bit flighty. She does a bit too much, and with the rise of the Senate, she gets arrested. That's the end of the game, and that carries you into Dominare, where the conspiracies are beginning to try to take control, right? From there, we have Mercante, which is another way we wanted to do Tempest, where Tempest is going to have sort of a plot line going on, which is mentioned the royalty losing power, the nobility losing power in the Senate rising, the merchants rising. But there's also what we're calling snapshot games, where it's just, we're going to take part of the city and just show you what goes on there during the day. And Mercante's kind of like that, where it's all the merchant houses auctioning and buying and selling ships that come in and the goods, and it has a fluctuating market system where actual supply and demand will affect how much you can get for completing contracts. Like, if everybody's been selling food into the market, then the food market's going to be flooded. You're not going to make as much money off of it. But also events will come up that will affect the market. Like, if you flip an event that's like, you know, visiting dignitaries, well, suddenly the luxuries market is worth a lot more because they all want the best wine and best stuff. So it's a snapshot of that. And of course, the merchant houses from Dominare show up. You get one of them, so you have an asynchronous ability every game. Somebody at your one merchant house, and say your merchant house is better at raw materials, you know, lumber and stone and stuff, so you get better deals buying and selling that. And another merchant house is probably a little shadier, so they get better effects when they do skullduggery, which basically lets you intercept goods as they're going to market and steal them and stuff like that. So those are the three boxed games, I'd say. The other one is Love Letter, which is the little 16-card card game from Seiji Kanai. It has been probably the hit of the show for us. It is Friday at 4 o'clock, and we are already sold out of all of it that we bought.
Wow.
Brought, I should say. It's just done fantastic for us. People are playing it all over the place. We're very excited.
We had a group of people playing at dinner. We had about 12 people, and half the table was playing Love Letter at one end of the table while the rest of us were having beer.
That is fantastic to hear. We're really excited about that. We're just very interested to see what Love Letter is going to do in the market. Such a little bitty game, and they did a great job packaging it. It's got a cute little drawstring bag with Love Letter embroidered on it.
And
the whole day. And the story, of course, behind Love Letter is that you're trying to win the heart of the princess, who's very distraught now because her mother got arrested, and everyone's trying to cheer her up and write her love letters and stuff like that. And it's about beating your competition to her. So.
Well, I love the sort of macro and micro scale that you can sort of focus or unfocus the lens by having all these games exist within this world and have a narrative that you have experience with L5R and
we
things
do.
That you're directing, where the players might have directed the narrative before. You have the publishers kind of laying out at least a framework of where you might want things to go, but then handing that to designers and saying, go nuts with it.
Yeah, that's the thing. We're, unlike L5R, where the players direct the narrative, but we really tell the story, we're letting the designers direct the narrative now. You know, there's a whole resource out there for them with bios on all the characters, story, you know, description of the city, even all the way down to like InDesign and Photoshop elements for them to create prototypes that look like Tempest games to send in, you know?
That's crazy.
And that way they can get to know the world, look at the games that are already out, and then come up with things that interest them. Like, say, maybe one designer just happens to be really interested in the play in the Senate going on right now, the struggle between the Senate and the nobles. The nobles are accustomed to their power and now they're not having it anymore. Maybe he wants to make a voting game or something like that about things in the Senate. So there's lots of territory to explore. Everything from that to the crime. There's a whole group of shadow men in Dominare who could be the crime in the city. So there's tons people can do with it. And we have about 5 or 6 games at various stages of development right now. Not all of them will necessarily make it to the end, but we have a lot of different games that are being worked on.
Now, with this sort of resource material, is this something that other up-and-coming designers can have access to that and go nuts and then present you with things?
Oh, absolutely.
Or is this something you only give to a specific designer?
Oh, no, it's wide open. If you go to alderac.com, you go to alderac.com/Tempest, and there's a little menu icon that says designer resource. It has a form you fill out. You put in your information, your contact info, send it in. Edward at our company, Edward Volme, will go through those and get in touch with you. And then there's a basic process. We ask people just send us a pitch. If you've got a prototype ready, great. But if you don't, just send us a pitch, write it up, tell you if we're interested. Then they can send a more developed, like, this is how the game's going to go, or a prototype. And then we'll keep working with them. And if it's something we decide to do, then we'll sign them on and go from there. And we've had a couple of designers who have already jumped a few of the hurdles and are now, well on their way to finishing some games for us. So,
see, it's such a creative way to encourage innovation.
Yeah.
I think you guys should get full kudos for finding a way to bring more designers into this really unique style.
Well, I'll do credit. Awesome. That was Edward. He came up with that whole idea. The moment we'd been working on Tempest for a couple years, actually. It had been sort of a background thing we'd been doing, and when he came on board, we handed the project to him, and one of the first things he thought was, well, if we want to keep the game going, let's get designers involved. And and he kind of wrote up the idea, and we went from there. So he had a great idea.
So we obviously see stacks of these games here. They're available here at Essen.
They are.
In terms of worldwide release and availability, what can you tell us?
Well, the Essen copies were, of course, advanced. We wanted to make sure they were here, given the type of games they were. But we are looking at mid-November to early December for retail release around the world.
Excellent, excellent. Well, before we go, is there any last little tidbit of information? Since you teased us so much last time,
right?
Are you going to tease us again, or
have
we been teased
again
enough?
Well, I think I already told you about Smash Up. We got an expansion coming for Smash Up.
Yes, yes.
That's done. That's well underway. We'll be previewing some of it as soon as the show's over. Teasing. See, the thing about Essen is you make a lot of deals at Essen that have to stay quiet for a long time.
Right.
But we're going to be doing some interesting things with some partners around the world now. So. We're very excited about our 2013. This isn't much of a tease, folks. I'm sorry. I can't really tell you a whole lot.
But
that's just the way this convention is. But we are making a lot of nice deals. We've had a lot of companies approach us, and we've talked to several. So
it's all more reason to go to alderac.com, right?
Bingo. Stay up on alderac.com. Follow us on Facebook at alderac and on Twitter as well. We have the @alderac there that gets all of our news. So for those of you who tweet, you can stay on top of it.
Well, thanks so much for taking time out to talk to us. We really appreciate it, and best of luck here at the rest of the show.
Thank you. I'm really glad you guys got to come.